And here we will discuss about further continuous random variable. Then that means various continuous random variable will come here. And in the last lecture, we had all this in that how to move from uniform law to non-uniform law. So all about that probability law, it helps to find probability density function in case of continuous random variable. Likewise, everywhere. So in module 1, we had already seen that probability law, it help to find explicit definition of probability measure. So with the help of probability law in module 1, we had already seen that it is giving an explicit definition of probability of an event. That one was in module 1. In module 2, we had already seen that probability law is giving probability mass function for discrete random variable. So we had already seen that uniform principle and non-uniform way PMF of discrete random variable. So this thing we had already seen. So now onward, we are trying to work on various probability law for continuous random variable. And if you apply probability law for continuous random variable, what we are getting? We are getting a PDF, probability density function. So if you are willing to find probability of an event, you need to know what kind of probability law you are applying. If you are willing to find probability mass function for a discrete random variable, you need to know what kind of probability law you are applying. If you are willing to find a probability density function of a continuous random variable, you need to know what kind of probability law you have applied. So always, what is that behind all these in right hand side, one kind of probability law is hidden there. So you need to know that how it is coming. So if you are understanding probability law in a better way, then you will be able to find these concepts, relevant concept, in order to see the pattern of observed value of random variable. So these are very much essential to understand, and further we will discuss about various things here. So coming to outline of today's lecture, first I would like to discuss about various continuous random variable. So uniform random variable we had already seen that. After that we will look for further other kind of random variable. Afterward, what is happening that our approach would be unification of probability pattern for discrete and continuous both. Anyone is having any question? Any question till now? No. Okay, fine. Going forward. So I am talking about here this cumulative distribution function. It is talking about unification of probability mass function and probability density function. That means unification of distribution pattern for both kind of random variable that we can define through cumulative distribution function. So that one is really interesting perspective, and why I am introducing, because it is giving one more wing to understand further variability of or possible of observation of a random variable, and hence we can introduce various other transformation of our derived distribution. We can, if we understand cumulative distribution in a better way, then it will help to come up with explicit form of or in the process of computing explicit form of distributed what we call it derived distribution. Derived distribution, that means function of random variable, whether it is continuous or discrete. So it would, in last example you had already seen one situation that we had taken a continuous random variable, but once we define a function of that random variable in different way, then that function of random variable, continuous random variable, happens to be a discrete. But such situation is not for discrete. If you are defining a discrete random variable and further you define a function over that discrete random variable, then that would be again a discrete random variable. But in case of continuous random variable, if you are defining function of a continuous random variable, then that may be a discrete or may be continuous, depends upon what situation in the process what you are defining. Okay, afterward we will discuss in detail about normal random variable. Why? Because I will take a specific lecture over normal random variable, and after that I will talk about application of normal random variable. Why? Because it is coming everywhere. So sometimes what is happening that you will be asked to find probability of an event without any idea of distribution. without any idea of distribution. So if distribution is not given to you, that means probability mass function or probability density function is not given to you, then how you can compute the probability of that event? It would be very much difficult. Then what you can do, you can approximate probability of that event by using normal distribution. That approximation process we'll discuss as an application of normal random variable or normal distribution. So that we will discuss in later class. So coming to first part of this lecture, that various continuous random variable, here we will introduce various, mostly we will start with uniform, and then we will go to non-uniform kind of continuous random variable. So here we are going to discuss about first uniform random variable, then we will introduce exponential random variable. So uniform random variable, what does it mean? If we are having a random variable that takes value between the interval with the help of equally likely principle, that means uniform law. This we are here, probability law is what? Uniform law. If x is taking value in equally likely framework, uniform law, then I had already told that in the case of continuous random variable, what is equally likely or what is uniform law. What does it mean? That means if you are taking any sub interval, any two sub interval of same length, then both would have the same probability. Okay, so that is meaning of equally likely. So due to that, we had already seen that if your x is observing value between a to b in this interval, then density function can be given by this constant 1 by b minus a when x is observing value between a to b. And if x is observing value outside a to b, because there is no observation of x outside a to b, so that's why density would be 0. So this one is what we are calling it. It is a uniform random variable, uniform continuous random variable, you can say that. Here density is constant. Simply density, due to uniform law, density is constant. And you can see the plot of probability density. That means x is taking observing value between a to b. That's why the density is having constant height. And it is satisfying all the properties of being a density function. What are those? It is greater than or equal to 0. And also you can see that normalizing property, also you can prove it like this way, that if you are finding the area of this curve, area of the this probability density function, that must be equal to 1. So if you are willing to find this, here probability density function for uniform distribution is what? It is constant. So it is so due to constant height, at width is also constant, length is b minus a. So if you are willing to find area of this rectangular, what would be? It would be just equal to height into width. That means 1 by b minus a times width of the interval b minus a. That means simply area would be 1. So area under a PDF always happens to be 1. That simply another geometrical visualization of normalizing property of density of a random variable. Now if suppose we are taking a random variable x which observe value from 0 to infinity, and where the probability law is defined by exponential function which decay as x is approaching to infinity. Okay, so here the probability law is defined by what? It is defined by some exponential law, exponential with parameter lambda, and it is just decaying to zero when x is approaching to infinity. That means through that exponential kind of probability law, we come up with the exponential distribution. What is the exponential distribution? We define it when x is greater than or equal to 0, then PDF is lambda times e to the power minus lambda x, and when x is negative, then PDF happens to be 0. Okay, so this kind of distribution we are calling it exponential distribution, and we can say that it is a it is talking about distribution of x which taking value in continuum fashion from the interval 0 to infinity. So x is a we can say that it is a exponential random variable having exponential distribution. And simply you can say see the plot of this one is for exponential random variable, the PDF it decay down to 0 when x is approaching to infinity. But if you find this overall area behind this curve, it would be equal to 1 in order to satisfy the normalizing condition. So this one is the exponential random variable. And even if what is happening, that a random variable is always characterized by the corresponding PDF. So just we have to look in the nature of PDF, what kind of nature PDF is having. So based on that, we are trying to give name to that random variable. So if this random variable is having exponential probability density function, that's why we are calling x is an what we call it, it is an exponential random variable. Now further, if you talk about other kind of random variable, that those are very much common in case of learning problem. So one of them is gamma distribution. So gamma distribution, again, if you say that, then the gamma, anyone would like to say that how we define gamma function? Anyone? Because you all are from EC, and I think gamma function is coming everywhere when you study for signal kind of things, then definitely gamma function would come here. So how we define gamma function? Anyone would like to recall how we define gamma function? It is one kind of generalization of factorial function, you can say that. Factorial is defined for non-negative integers, and gamma is defined for real number, positive, non-negative real number. So tell me, what is the gamma function, anyone? So gamma distribution is inspired from the gamma function, and that explicit form of gamma function. So it is talking about integral. It is happens to be all these notation came through what we call it Euler. He was a famous mathematician, Russian mathematician. So e to the power minus t and t to the power alpha minus t, and we are integrating with respect to t. So that's where dt will come. So this one is the gamma function. Everyone might be aware of this. We call it gamma function. Here alpha must be, for existence of this integral, alpha must be greater than 0. So that is the criteria. And here even this gamma function, you can generalize it for complex argument as well. So alpha may be complex. In that case, this condition would be generalized to that real part of gamma must be positive. So in that case, real part of gamma, if gamma is, alpha is complex, then real part of gamma must be greater than positive, 0. It must be positive. So that is the situation for complex. So that is gamma function. So what is happening, that if you are having a random variable x which is taking value continuously from interval 0 to 1, and the probability law is described by a gamma like function with two parameter alpha and beta here coming. Okay, so gamma like function, how we define gamma like function? So it is coming like this way. Here you can say e to the power minus t is coming there. Here we can say e to the power minus lambda x times x to the power alpha minus 1. So you can see that it is this function is very much resemblance with this function. So here not parameter alpha beta, we will take parameter only lambda. We are taking parameter lambda is the parameter. Later I will say that why we are calling it parameter lambda. There is a meaning of that. When we will introduce expectation and variance, then you will come to know why it is parameter. Okay, so lambda is here, it is behaving like a parameter because it is having direct relation with mean and variance. So mean and variance can be expressed in term of just lambda. So that's why lambda we are calling it parameter. So here we are defining the distribution of x, distribution function of x, or probability density function of x with the help of gamma like function. That means probability law is inspired from gamma like function. Gamma kind of function, simply we can say that. And so if x is taking value from this in interval 0 to infinity through probability law, which depends upon gamma like function or gamma kind of function, then we can say that probability density function would be like this way. This is the probability density function. Okay, and here gamma of alpha, it is defined as a, what we call it, we are saying that it is gamma function. The definition of gamma function. So that's where this one is what? It is gamma distribution. That x is having a distribution, that distribution we are calling it gamma distribution. And if you try to plot the gamma distribution, then it would have behaved like this one. So this peak picky notation, it is talking about it is highly dependent upon lambda. As you change lambda, this peak will keep on changing. So one kind of things, if I am asking that askew, it is having askewness. So what kind of askewness it is having? Anyone would like to say that? What kind of askewness it is having? Yeah, left askew. Just we have to focus on the tail. Don't we have to focus on the peak position? We have to focus on tail. Where tailness is more, that will decide the askewness. Okay, so that is the concept. Now another interesting kind of distribution is coming with respect to beta functions, and hence what is happening that will introduce beta distribution. So here again we are taking a random variable x, which is observing value between 0 to 1. Okay, and here the probability law is defined by a beta like function. So in beta, while defining beta like function, two parameters are coming. One is alpha by default, that with respect to gamma function, and beta is coming with respect to beta function. Okay, so that's why the corresponding protein density function, we will call it beta protein density function. So it is defined like this way. We know that how we define beta function. So beta function, generally it is defined between 0 to 1. It is talking about integral of x to the power alpha minus 1 minus x to the power beta minus 1, and we are integrating with respect to x. So this we are calling it beta function. It is actually this one was gamma notation, and beta we can call it beta. We have taken this one capital form of beta. I'm just you write it like this, capital B, like okay, capital B of alpha and beta. So this one is the beta function. So you can here easily see that this random variable x, which is taking value from 0 to 1 in continuum fashion through a probability law. That probability law is characterized by beta kind of function. So this is the, due to the, using that beta function, we are getting corresponding protein density function. This is the protein density function. So all these are what, non-uniform kind of continuous random variable. Here when x is observing value 0 to 1, f of the density is given by beta kind of function, and when x is observing value from outside 0 to 1, we don't have any value of x, and hence density would be 0. So this kind of random variable we are calling it beta random variable, and the corresponding protein density function we are calling it beta distribution. So we can see for various value of beta, we can see different situation. So if you are taking beta equal to 5 and alpha equal to 5, both are same, then it is giving Gaussian distribution kind of approach. That means it is symmetric. Here easily we can say that this, if alpha equal to 5 and beta equal to 5, in that situation we observe that it is symmetric about to mean position. Here mean position would be here, mean of this one it would be here. Mean actually alpha beta we are calling it parameter y, because here you need to compute two things, expectation, and I haven't defined expectation. That's why I'm not computing expectation and variance. Okay, after this I will introduce that. So we need to compute variance, we need to compute expectation. So here expectation and variance both would be just function of alpha and beta, and variance would be also function of alpha and beta. That's why we are calling alpha and beta parameter. Why? Because actually expectation and variance happens to be parameter of a distribution. And if that expectation variance, they are having very unique kind of representation with respect to some another number, then that number becomes parameter. So that's why we are saying that alpha beta are parameter. So if you are taking value alpha equal to 5 and beta equal to 5, then you are seeing a very symmetric kind of protein density function, which is symmetric about mean position. You can see that. So it is very much it is having resemblance with Gaussian distribution, that we will see it later. And if you say that what is happening, that if you take alpha equal to 8 and beta equal to 2, then you see askewness in the PDF. So it is having what left askewness. Okay, so this kind of left askewness we observe that if asymmetric value of alpha and beta, if you take, then we see askewness. Okay, or simply we can say that the corresponding PDF would be asymmetric due to asymmetric value of alpha and beta. Asymmetric means not symmetric. And likewise, if you take alpha equal to 2 and beta equal to 8, then you will say right skewed or asymmetric, right? Asymmetric PDF. So this is the situation. So various, it depends upon various value of alpha and beta. You can keep on changing alpha and beta, you will get different kind of PDF for the beta beta random variable. Okay, now here we actually we had already introduced expectation and variance, I think. So if I'm asking to compute expectation of exponential random variable, x is as exponential random variable, that means x here, what is the density of x? If you are saying x is exponential random variable, in short we are writing it x e x p with parameter lambda. So what would be the distribution? Anyone recall? It would be lambda time, yeah, lambda x, when x is greater than equal to 0, and it is 0 otherwise. Or otherwise, what is meaning of that? When x is less than 0. So if you, I am asking to find expectation of this exponential random variable, then what you have to do, you have to integrate the weighted value of x. What is meaning of weighted value of x? That means you multiply x with probability of observing x. Okay, so what is, how that one is coming? That one is coming through infinitesimal, that means observation of density in infinitesimal length or sub interval. So that means how, what is that property? That property f of x times d of x. F of x is, it is talking about density, and d of x it is talking about infinitesimal width. So that's why I am saying that multiply x with corresponding weight. It is given by this, okay, density time d of x, and we are integrating it from where we need to integrate it from minus infinity to infinity, but here for minus infinity to up to 0, this one, this value is 0. So that's why we won't bother about minus infinity to 0, it would be 0. So just we have to integrate from 0 to infinity. So what is integral of this from 0 to infinity? That means you have to integrate it like this way. You can take it like this way. You can put it here minus infinity. What would be integral? So here 0 to minus infinity to 0, it is 0. So we have to just integrate from 0 to infinity x time lambda into e to the power minus lambda x with respect to x. Tell me, what is the integral of this? It is a definite integral, so it would be a fixed number. What would be that integral? Just simplify it, value of this one would be lambda. So you can say that expectation of exponential random value is equal to lambda. Okay, likewise, also if you are willing to calculate variance, would you like to compute this? So lambda, this one is constant, so it will come out. So just you will have x time e to the power minus lambda time x. So you need to find it. Okay, also likewise, also you can compute variance of x. So anyone, have you computed this one? Just try to compute this integral. Apply by parts. So here, yeah, there would be no any issue with lambda. You can take it out. So only you have to integrate from 0 to infinity of what is integrand? Integrand is x times e to the power minus lambda times x dx, just you need to integrate. Anyone just do calculation this and tell me what is the, whether it is lambda or 1 by lambda. You have to see the value. Do compute in your copy and just tell me the value. So here what is happening, that it is 1 by lambda. So that's where I had doubt a little bit. It is 1 by lambda. Thank you. So it is 1 by lambda. And then what would be variance? Likewise, also you will see that what would be variance if you try to calculate. So variance would be 1 by lambda square. Right? Yeah, very nice. So here you can see that expectation and variance both are expressed in term of lambda. Okay, that's where we are saying that lambda is the parameter of this distribution, exponential distribution. Lambda is the parameter, because here expectation and variance happens to be parameter of a distribution. With respect to each distribution, how you can generally express things in a simple way with the help of expectation and variance. So those are actually parameter of a distribution, and here both parameter are expressed in term of lambda, and as lambda becomes a parameter of the distribution, that's why we are seeing that. Likewise, we can compute expectation of other random variable. Okay. Now we are going to discuss about another part of this lecture, that one is cumulative distribution function. So it is what we discussed, that till now we have to come seen, we have already seen that protein mass function for discrete random variable, and what is happening, that protein density, protein mass function happens to be a probability. It is defined as that we observe probability of observing value x, that random variable x is observing value x. So this one is, there is no issue with protein mass function. It is directly dealing with probability of observing that specific value. Okay, and in case of discrete continuous random variable, we had a density function. So generally what is happening, that density function is not talking about probability. We have to multiply with a width, then it would be converted into probability. So we see definitely there are two different kind of things. These two are two different kind of things. So how we can unify these things together? So that means this density function with multiplication with delta, it is giving talking about probability that x is observing value between x and x plus delta. Okay, so here little bit what we observe, that difference between these two approach of distribution pattern from so what we do, we will talk about unification of these two, how we can unify. So we can unify these two with the help of a cumulative distribution function, that we denote it by capital F of x. So this unification, it is talking about what? It is talking about that probability that a random variable x is observing value up to x, up to this a specific x. So it is, so a cumulative distribution function always, it is talking about probability. It is always expressed in term of probability, whether the random variable is continuous or discrete, there is no any issue. Always a cumulative distribution function will talk about probability. But here in case of continuous random variable, density function is not talking about probability. When you multiply with a width, then it becomes a probability. But if you define a cumulative distribution function, it will always discuss about probability. So that's why it is giving a unified notion of distribution pattern for any kind of random variable. And it is also helping a lot in order to compute problem where mixed kind of random variable will come. So you will see, I have taken a few examples based on that. So unification of probability density function for discrete, or probability mass function for discrete, or probability density function continuous random variable, can be accumulated probability up to a certain value x as a cumulative distribution function. That means how we define it. Suppose it is, so simply see that the definition of cumulative distribution function, it is defined like this way. This is the definition part. This is the definition. This cumulative distribution function is talking about, it is that probability that random variable x is observing value up to x. So this is the definition. So further, if you open up it with respect to different class of random variable. Suppose x is a discrete random variable, then what you do? It is talking about probability of that x is observing value up to x, and x is discrete. In that case, what is happening? That means we have to sum up all the probability mass function up to x. Up to x, the k will vary up to x. So that means summation is k will start from 0 to x or minus infinity to x, depends upon what kind of value x is taking. If x is taking integral integer kind of value, then it will vary from minus infinity to infinity. That we can say that okay, so that situation would come. So here the integral fashion, so summation is like up to x, simply focus on up to that. What is this x? So we will sum up to that only. Okay, that is the approach. But suppose if x happens to be a continuous random variable, then how we can find cumulative distribution function? That means we have to, summation would be here converted into integral. So we have to integrate the density function up to x. So we are integrating in another way. What we do? We are summing this probability. If you take these two in together, it is talking about probability, that f of t into dt. It is talking about probability. But if you talk from the integral perspective, it is talking about integration of f with respect to t. Okay, so that's where we are integrating up to x, and this one we are summing up to x for discrete random variable. For continuous, we are integrating up to x in order to get cumulative distribution function, in short CDF function. So that is the perspective. Okay, so this one is simply talking about unification. So we are getting a unique notation for CDF, for discrete and continuous. Definitely, if you go in deeper way, both are different, but no worry. In the first definition wise, both are same. Okay, so suppose we take a random variable x, and we are taking a specific kind of event which is observing value between xi and xi plus 1. That means x is taking value in continuum fashion, in that we observe a subinterval, ith subinterval xi plus 1. Okay, so what will happen, that so here we can see f of x is what, that it is talking about probability density function at x, and then what is that? This one is probability per unit area. That means we are finding the probability that x is observing value between xi to xi plus 1 and divide by width of the interval. That one is probability per unit area, because here x is taking value along one dimensional. So area would be what? Length. One dimensional. So area, simply don't confuse with area. So here x is taking value in one dimensional framework. So that's why area is length. So our width, simply width of the subinterval. So here the density function is defined as this ratio, and if you further see, if you are willing to express this one in with respect to CDF, then what would be this? So it is talking about here we had already seen that probability up to x, we are saying that it is talking about CDF, capital F of x. Okay, now if I'm asking what is meaning of probability that x is greater than equal to a, what is meaning of this? Anyone would like to highlight what is meaning of this, how we can express this term? X is greater than equal to a. So you can remember that here a would be somewhere here. So this segment, we are always, if you are taking a real number, it is always giving a trichotomy or bichotomy also, you can say that. So this left segment, we say that x is less than or equal to a, and right segment we say that x is greater than or equal to a. So one situation I had already expressed that. So what is meaning of complement? If you take complement of event x is greater than or equal to a, complement of this one, what is this? It is talking about the event that x is less than or equal to a. Okay, so same situation is coming, that if you are willing to calculate probability that x is greater than or equal to a, what does it talk about? It is talking about probability that probability of complement of x is less than equal to a complement here coming. Okay, I think this thing might be clear to everyone. Is it clear or not? And further, what you will write it here? Here, probability of complement, how we write, so this result you might have already seen that. If you are willing to find probability of complement of an event, that means if you are willing to find probability of a complement, what is happening? It is equal to 1 minus probability of a. Why? Because a and a complement, it is always describing a partition of the sample space with only two member. So that means if this one is your sample space, then this one is A, then this one would be A complement. So A and A complement in together, they are defining a partition of a sample space. So that's why only with only two members. So that's why here we are, due to that, we can say that if you are willing to find probability of X greater than equal to A, it is just equal to probability of complement of X event, X less than equal to A. And hence we can say that it would be, this probability would be equal to 1 minus probability that X is observing value up to A. So that situation is coming. So here we can introduce the same fragment here. Okay, so here now situation is coming. Now one more result you need to know here. What is that result? So this one was probability of X greater than equal to A. One more result is what? That means if suppose you are willing to calculate probability of that X is taking value between two real number A to B. So in that case, how you can compute probability for that kind of event when X is observing value between A to B. So here, if you geometrically willing to see, that means X is taking value between A to B. Then if you talk about event up to B, it is talking about event X is taking value up to B. And then if you talk about this event, then it is talking about event that X is taking value up to A. Then how you can find probability that X is taking value between A to B? That means you have to subtract probability of X up to A from probability of X up to B. Then you will get probability that X is observing value between A to B. So that's why here probability between A to B, it would be what? Difference of probability that X is observing value up to B minus probability that X is observing value up to A. From geometry, this result might be clear to everyone. So that's why we have taken this kind of we have translated this one into this. Now here we can see that what does it talk about. It is saying that probability that up to xi plus 1, and this one is talking about probability up to xi plus 1. So what is this one? This one simply it would be CDF, that CDF of value of CDF at xi plus 1. It is from the definition of CDF, it would be f of xi plus 1, and from the definition of CDF, it would be f of xi. So we can see that here the density function is approximated by this divided difference. This is the divided difference, we can say that. And if you take limit when xi is approaching to xi plus 1, or xi plus 1 is approaching to xi from right, so that if you take limiting case, then where this divided difference will approach to derivative of the cumulative distribution function. And hence we say that f of x is what? It is actually derivative of the cumulative distribution function. Cumulative distribution function, what we say that. So this is the really interesting situation in case of continuous random variable. In discrete, it would be different, but in case of continuous density, you can say that probability density function, it happens to be derivative of the cumulative distribution function. Likewise, we can here, I have already one more property you can observe here is that what is the property of CDF or cumulative distribution function is that it is increasing in nature. That means if you take any two observed value of random variable x, that x and x dash, and suppose x is less than equal to x dash, then automatically we know that this event would be a subset of this event. Here geometry, through geometry you can always see that. Here in geometry, x dash is here, x is here, x dash is here. So easily you can see that this, if you talk about event, this one up to this x, it is talking about event x is less than equal to small x, and this event is talking about x is less than equal to x dash. So easily you can say that this event is a subset of, it is already contained in this event. So that's why we are saying that subset. And due to that, what will happen if you are willing to find property that x is observing value up to x and x is observing value up to x dash, then we will see, automatically we will see that this property would be greater than or equal to this property. And hence, what is this one? This one simply is capital F of x value of CDF at x, and this one is capital F of x dash from the definition of CDF. So we can easily see that CDF is always monotonically increasing function. Apart from that, if you are willing to compute value of CDF at infinity, then you can define it as in this fashion. So we know that value of CDF at infinity, what it would be, that it is talking about that x is taking value less than infinity. That means we are including all possible observation of x. Then simply what does it? It is satisfying normalizing condition, and hence property of this one would be equal to 1. That means value of CDF at plus infinity is 1, and value of CDF at minus infinity, that means impossible event. There is no observation of x, simply it say. So that's why probability would be 0. So value of CDF at minus infinity is 0. So very much what you got the structure of CDF. What is that structure? So structure, you can see it like this way. So let me remove. A structure of CDF, it is coming like this way. A plot of CDF. So you can see that here y equal to 0 and y equal to 1 happens to be asymptote of the CDF. What is meaning of asymptote of CDF? That means as x is approaching to infinity, this CDF, capital F of x, it is approaching to 1. So it is not going to cross this y equal to 1. It will just tangent. It will touch. It will try to touch y equal to 1. So that means that we are saying that asymptotic in nature. That means if you are willing to find limiting value of the this CDF when x is approaching to plus infinity, then what would be limiting value when x is approaching to plus infinity? So limiting value would be equal to 1. So that means it is just trying to touch when x value of x is very high, the density function is trying to touch y equal to 1, but it won't cross y equal to 1. Likewise, limiting value of this CDF is 0 when x is approaching to minus infinity. When x is approaching to minus. So this one is talking about asymptotic behavior of the CDF. It is equal to 0. You can see from the plot. So this is all about the story of density. Okay, we will try to compute the CDF of few a specific example. So do we have time? Okay, few example I will try. After that I will wind up. So here here one interesting application of CDF, we will see it here. That one question is coming that suppose there is a random variable which is talking about maximum score. So simply this maximum score would be defined in different way, and we need to compute protein mass function of this one, because this maximum score would be discrete in nature. That's why we will compute protein mass function. If directly you are willing to tackle this problem, you will face problem. But if you go from CDF approach, your job would be simple. How? Suppose your question is coming like this way. You are allowed to take a certain test 3 times. There is a test you can appear in 3 times, okay, and your final score would be maximum of all those 3 tests, which would be maximum, that would be your final score. So that is the situation. Now here, that means this maximum score, we call it random variable x. So this x would be defined as maximum of x1, x2, x3. x1 is talking about a score of the first test, x2 is talking about the score of second test, x3 is talking about a score in the third test. Okay, and x is maximum of these two, and hence x would be final score, you can say. So assume that your score in each test takes one of the value from 1 to 10. So x1 is observing value 1 to 10 with equal likely probability, 1 by 10. x2 is taking value 1 to 10 with equal likely probability. x3 is taking value 1 to 10 with probability density of mass function 1 by 10. So what is the density of or probability mass function of x1? It is just constant one, it is 1 by 10 uniform, or also you can say that it is uniform. So P of x1, xi I would like to write, P of xi, it is given, it is equal to 1 by 10, it is for I equal to 1 to 3, I equal to 1 to 3, okay. So we know the probability mass function of x1, x2, x3, we need to calculate probability mass function of x. So if simply I am asking to compute this, it would be very difficult. So if you go through CDF approach, then it would be simple. How? You can see that. So we are trying to define CDF for x, because here x is a final score, a maximum of these three. So CDF of x, it will define capital F of k, it will define that probability, that random variable x is observing value up to k. Okay, up to k. So if what is meaning of, if maximum mass is less than equal to k, what does it say? That means this value is less than equal to k. It simply says that x1 would be less than equal to k, and x2, when maximum mass is less than equal to k, that means each one is less than equal to k. So that's why x1 is less than equal to k, x2 is less than equal to k, and x3 is less than equal to k. So all these three happens to be jointly, okay. And if you see x1 is independent of x2, x2 is independent of x3, x3 is independent of x1. So all there is independency between any two xi. So that's why this joint probability is what? It is just in case of independent situation, this joint probability, it is just product of the individual probability density function. And hence we can get the value of CDF of x. So what is CDF of the probability of this one is what? Up to k, that means you are summing 1 by 10, how many times? K times. So it becomes k by 10, this also becomes k by 10, this also becomes k by 10, and hence you are getting CDF of x as k by 10 to the power 3. You got the CDF of x. So now here, how to find probability mass function. It is a discrete random variable. So probability mass function, simply here x is taking value CDF, it will come that x is taking value in what? Discretely. So if k is coming, next value would be k plus 1. So if someone is saying that x equal to k, what does it talk about? It is just equivalently, you can say that in case of inequality sign, you can say that x is taking value between k and k plus 1. And due to that, so here this if you talk about this probability is equivalent to, if you put here probability, then this one is equivalent to, it is probability that x is taking value up to equal to k plus 1 minus x is taking value equal to this equivalency, easily you can say that. And What is this one? This one is f of k plus 1, and this one is f of k. For discrete situation, it is just what difference of value of CDF at two consecutive value. So that's where just take difference at here we are computing at k, so it would be kn, k minus 1 would come here k. So here simply we will fix situation like that, x is observing value between k minus 1 and k. So that's where this difference will come, and we know the explicit form of CDF of x. So and hence we can compute these two, and this is the desired protein mass function of this maximum score. We can get it. If I'm asking it directly compute, then it would be very difficult, but with the help of CDF easily we can compute it. Other problem we will discuss in next class regarding attendance. Just put